but I essentially was building out trading algorithms for them, and that was sort of 2008-2009. At that point in time, I also kind of played online poker, and that was good fun for quite a while. The orange bits on this slide sort of show my trading history and how I sort of got into blockchain, because I always use blockchain as sort of another way to make money, rather than, so it was a flexible market, it was a dynamic market, and the liquidity allowed me to make some profitable trades. However, I didn't really see blockchain as anything else. I didn't think about the value proposition behind the chain. So it wasn't until sort of late 2015, early 2016 that I was introduced to Ethereum and the DAO and became quite interested in the value proposition and what the community was doing with blockchain. So here we just, I've got a few slides about the DAO. The DAO is a decentralized autonomous organization, and that was set up to allow people to put money into a big fund and then to use voting to decide how that money would be used, whether it would be to purchase assets, to trade on other cryptos, et cetera, et cetera. There's a number of different implementations of the DAO right now, and there's not just Ethereum.
It's interesting that it was 15, 16 that you found the value proposition of blockchain technology, because as you say, you were here when we had the symposium right in this room in late 2016. So it's very similar to myself that, you know, found the value proposition and then got quite curious about how we could look at the technology to start to solve problems. So when you, I guess my interest in too is was this around the time that Flux Party started to come into your periphery, like about what that was going to do, why was Flux something that you were interested in doing, and how does that, I guess, intertwine with your timeline? Because this is a really big, important thing, Flux, because they actually are a political party that were on the last ballot paper.
That's right. So I had, I finished sort of all of the courses that I could do in the maths physics department, and I had some room to fill in my uni schedule. So I decided to do a quick advanced course in social justice and democratic form. And at that point in time, I had been reading about the DAO and sort of seeing how blockchain could be used for voting. And it was my studies in democratic form and understanding the differences between representational, liquid, fluid, and direct democracy that got me interested in Flux and sort of alternate methods of governance. So I went online and I sort of, like, there's a number of organizations that were out there. There was a couple coming out of, I think it's Democracy Now, coming out of Argentina. There was Flux, and then at that point in time, MeVote was around, although I think they were just sort of doing
Community voting,
that's right. So Flux interested me because they were an established political party, and they actually had the blockchain technology to implement the voting mechanism. So I joined up and started the Flux Queensland group, and we are now a registered political party, which we're celebrating our registration on Wednesday this week. And I'll be stepping down from party secretary to move into nationals to do a bit more work on party internals and, obviously legal compliance stuff, which isn't so interesting. But Flux is really quite interesting because it allows, you know, we don't really understand right now the sort of trade-offs that people make when they're voting. So you have a political party with a platform, and each party has their own platform, and you have to then decide, okay, well, maybe I'll forego education because healthcare is more important to me right now. But what Flux allows us to do, and you know, we'll, the metadata on voting will be free for everybody to use and to create knowledge. But the idea of finding out what sort of trade-offs that we're making politically, to me, is the underlying reason why I believe in Flux. I think that
in the future we'll be moving to more towards radical pluralisms, whereas, you know, we won't be confined by certain boxes, and, you know, tax laws will be implemented against different individuals differently depending on how they live their life and what sort of choices they make. Right now we don't have the knowledge to make those choices, so I think that blockchain gives us the transparency and provenance to allow those sorts of developments.
So, because that's interesting, because the idea that you could actually vote on your subject area rather than the person or the political party starts to change up the way we can actually influence, I guess, public policy and where money can go and taxation and things like that. So that's an interesting thing, because right now we only have two parties really in this country that we can vote for. And if you don't like either of them, then you're the minorities. But what you're actually saying is about an issue-based application.
That's right. One of the things that we want to do, rather than having each party create their own policy, is create a system where essentially policy is crowdfunded and iterated on based on sort of like another voting mechanism. We're calling it a liquidity token. So they'll be issued to everybody on a UBI basis. So essentially the value of the token, you know, decreases over time, but because people keep getting more and more of them monthly, they'll be allowed to use those tokens to iterate on policy and to push policy through to parliament. So it allows for, because you'll be able to vote on the things that you care about rather than, you know, making those choices in a representational system, then we think that it'll allow more knowledge and experts to come out and give their opinion on you know.
Well, it should be experts that have, guide our choices and things like that.
In Queensland right now, we don't have a Senate, so we have sort of working groups that are put together. And one of my frustrations, this was back when they were doing research on the reef and the effect of the port going in, and I sent some papers that a friend of mine in the biology department at UQ had flicked over to me, and I was told by the Senate representative, or sorry, the working group representative, that they chose what papers they wanted to read, and they don't actually take any sort of recommendations either from academics themselves or from the greater public. And yeah, I think that sort of it got me sort of infuriated, and this was just probably about a year and a half before I came to Flux. And I think that allowing people to decide what's important, what's of value, and what the government should be reading and looking at when making decisions is really quite important.
So if you were to say, like, okay, so when you'd be looking at, if you were applying Flux into the next election, say, oh, obviously, Tasmania's just done their state election, so how would, in a very quick way, just for everyone to understand, how would the practicality of that work in an election?
Okay, well, the real juice of Flux doesn't really happen until we end up with the balance of power in Parliament, because what we've got is a three-step model. We've got your direct democracy, which means that you get a token and you can vote on an issue as it goes through Parliament. But then, well, you can also use liquid democracy, which means that you pass on that token to somebody who you feel has more knowledge in that area. And that's for the vote as the policy is put and tabled in Parliament. But we're changing the sort of 51% rule, you know, if IBDD were to be instantiated. And what we would do then is have, say, you have to win 2/3 of the vote in order to pass a law. And if you didn't get 2/3 in Parliament, then that's when the policy then goes into sort of, well, I'm just going to say it, people kind of get a bit up in arms about it, but essentially what we're doing is we're creating an after marketplace for consensus and decision making. So those liquidity tokens that you have, if you really care about a policy, say, let's just use gay marriage for an example. You could use all of the liquidity tokens that you've accumulated to vote on that issue for or against. And so that allows us now to reweight the importance that we give to certain issues. And that's how we get better information about the trade-offs that people are making and what's actually important to the country. But of course, none of that really happens until we get the balance of power. If we were to get one member in parliament, then everybody in the electorate that the member came from would vote on their app or on a phone, and the member would vote in parliament as per the outcome of the voting app.
So how do everyone in this room become a member of Flux?
VoteFlux.org and join up on the membership page. Also, please feel free to come out. We're meeting at Botanical Gardens at 10 a.m. on Wednesday, and then we're going to be walking to Parliament House, and then in the evening we're having dinner. So if you check the VoteFlux Queensland Facebook page, you can find all of the details about that event.
I'll put that through, so you've got that information. So I'll let you finish your timeline, because I'm really keen to get us into the carbon conversation. But I was going to say, does anyone have any direct questions for Riley at this point in time around Flux? I think, yes, we have a taker in the back there.
I'm Simon. Just a quick one. So you're saying tokens going to be issued over a certain amount of time to a certain amount of people, and then you can use as many tokens as you want on a certain issue you feel really strongly about. Say if you had like marriage equality vote that just happened, and then everyone used all their tokens, what happens when the next bit of policy or legislation comes along and everyone's just, there's hardly any left in the pool?
That's right. I mean, this is actually really quite an important issue. What we need to happen along with pushing the Flux agenda is also democratic education to teach people how to make decisions and work in sort of a decentralized and a sort of autonomous way to control their what we'll call political capital, if you will. It might be that some of, maybe some of the younger 18, 19 year olds might do that, but then I think as you get older, you sort of learn that, oh, well, if I'm gonna make this choice now, then when this comes up in the future, then I will be able to use my credits towards it. But you can see what's sort of happening in Parliament ahead of time. And I guess it depends on how involved you are in policy choices and how in depth you want to go. But yeah, given that the government puts out sort of requests for people to make comment on policy before it's tabled, you kind of know what's coming through the pipeline.
Is it a one-to-one? Can you trade? Could you have someone provide you with their voting token?
Okay, so we do get asked this question a lot. It's not a trade. It's not a swap.
Right.
So, I could give my vote on a specific issue to you because I deem you to be more knowledgeable and therefore better able to make the decision than I can. Two things happen. First of all, if I give my vote to you, you then, in order to accept that vote, you have to make public the way that you're voting. Second of all, you don't know that it's come from me, so you don't know who that vote has been given to you from. given to you from. Thank you. And then I can redact my vote at any time. So if at any point in time, say you decide that you're going to vote the other way on an issue, after I can take that vote back before. Yeah.
So it's the only part of blockchain that seems like there isn't provenance, because there's provenance on everything else except for potentially the provenance of that knowledge of the information of the person who bestowed that voting right to me.
To you.
So you have an anonymity.
That's right. So we've had to do that, obviously, because then you can, you worry about corruption or, collusion, pressure to vote a certain way, either from family members or religious groups or academic communities. So sort of keeping that knowledge of who has bestowed that vote on you private is.
Okay,
thank
you.
Idea.
There was another,
So sounds very exciting. But my concern is that there's a lot of change that actually needs to be accepted before something can, before actions, before it starts getting a lot of traction.
Certainly.
And I was wondering whether the other alternative that I was conceiving of is that an individual already elected member might use blockchain voting for lots of lower issues, but then rather than it being a debate in a party room, suddenly that member's saying, you know what, I've got this many people in my electorate voting on this private blockchain, and that gives me the evidence to say, party, we're wrong, change. Is that...
So you're talking about using a similar sort of system within a party?
Yeah, and just the possibility that I loved was the idea that an individual member might say, run up their own blockchain, run voting on a whole range of issues, and then start resourcing their internal debate within the party on the basis
of the voting that's come
of
through.
Of the voting,
yeah.
And the knowledge around micro issues and a broader range of issues, rather than individual politicians just talking about, oh, I've heard from my electorate, well, could be one person or nobody.
That's right. I mean, we do already have national polling on a lot of issues, so you're right. I mean, it's an interim step. I don't think that that's going to take us all the way there,
yeah.
But like you said, the instantiating the Flux system is going to involve a number of changes, including at the end a constitutional change. So, it's not a short game. It's definitely, we're sort of looking 100, 200 years out. Took 12 to 1400 years to come up with a good, an all right representational democracy. It's going to take us a long time to change to something a bit more direct.
So, did you want to just keep going into your timeline and then we might move into EE3?
Well, I don't know. We've sort of chatted and I don't know how relevant this slide is. I can kind of boom through it. I mean, you had asked me to think about some questions about why I'm interested in emerging technologies such as blockchain. So, with the DAO, I think, it's the transparency, provenance, and accountability that's going to sort of create this knowledge revolution. So I am going to flip through these slides rather quick, but there are some here that would be worth talking about. So just the idea that control and power are essentially the value propositions of centralization. So one of the things that Flux does is it exposes power imbalances, and then we don't necessarily have to remove those. Like, removing them isn't always the way to go, but if we expose them and we know about them, then at least, we're making that choice on our own volition rather than it sort of being closed door. And then I thought that this quote was rather relevant. Knowledge has always been the driving force of change in human societies. And like I said, I do believe that we are on sort of a knowledge revolution here that blockchain will help us move through. This is all sort of value propositions that everybody knows about blockchain technology, the fact that it's being used everywhere, this idea. taking out the middleman. So one of the things that the knowledge revolution will, I think, cause sort of a consumer revolution, and then from that consumer revolution, you're going to have a corporate revolution, because the corporates are now going to have to deal with sort of the choice and consumers being able to make choice based on knowledge. So we're going to be seeing more transparency and price setting, fingers crossed. What you want to know when you look into your supply chain is, okay, what just happened at the step back? How much did it cost? And what sort of value am I deriving from the price that I'm paying at that point in the supply chain? Do I want to continue to use that service, or should I have it, my product put through a different sort of pathway? And in terms of changing business processes, I think blockchain is really quite special, because it allows us to expose and create that transparency without giving up our trade secrets or our important business IP. Because what we can do is we can decide through smart contracts and when that knowledge gets exposed through the supply chain. So
So I was like, okay, what do we call this slide? Knowledge in doubt, individualistic, consumer producer pluralisms. So just the idea that again that you know, when the individual becomes the owner of their own data, the system changes. When we have access to knowledge, then we choose things that are relevant to us and our value proposition. And then the fact that within the supply chain, individuals aren't just going to be consumers anymore. It's going to be, you know, you become a producer as well as a consumer, because you and what it is that you want from the product feeds back into the production loop itself. And then I've got here the outcome, radical pluralisms in terms of options, choice, and modes of interaction. All right. I am one of these Step 5 PowerPoint sort of girls. We'll move on to my current project. And here we go. I'm advising on a project that's really quite interesting called Metavents, and we're using a combination of blockchain technology, VR, Metavents was a software system that helped people plan festivals and large events. And now what they're doing is they're using virtual reality mapping, creating events at places where there could be either, well, generally not social, but more environmental sort of disasters coming up, like, you know, hurricanes, flooding, this sort of thing. So you have an event, the whole area gets mapped by VR, and then the VR mappings that you make have both a commercial and a non-for-profit aspect. So commercially, they're actually filming the festival, and you'll have maybe liquor companies or clothing companies or things like that have advertising, and so that's commercializing the technology. But then we're also using those VR mappings to go through and do sort of disaster mitigation and recovery. And one of the projects that we're planning on looking in is identifying individuals in these areas that might need to be evacuated some global warming catastrophe such as a hurricane or a flood, and issuing them visas on the blockchain so that we can get them out of high intensity areas much more quickly. So the main project that I'm working on right now is a project that we're calling Ecosystem Exchange. The website is EE3, we'll just put through blocks, EE3.io. And what are we doing? We are creating a platform where we can tokenize and trade ecosystem services, pollutant licenses, and green assets. So I met my business partner actually through Flux, which is quite interesting. And he came to me, he's been a forester for 25 years, and he said, I think that there's a potential blockchain solution to the problem of carbon trading in Australia. So some of the supply chain pains that we've identified, the fact that ACCUs in Australia, they treat all CO2 equivalents equal in terms of paying projects through the ERF, the Emissions Reduction Fund. So whether you're just burning methane at a tip, which they do anyways, but B, is it not very expensive to get the project running and to produce the carbon credits, versus planting at a forest, which has much greater impact on the environment. They're all priced the same through the ERF, the government prices the same. So what we're looking at doing is we're looking at breaking down and tokenizing the ACCU by method so that we can create a marketplace where individuals and businesses value the carbon credits as they do. So, you know, we'll help set initial prices based on the cost of running the projects, but after that, we'll let free market mechanisms take over and then become a price-setting mechanism. So, you know, obviously what we want to do is we want to look at sort of all of the value adds that these projects contribute to both the environment and society, and have those externalities priced in with the cost of the carbon credit. So why are we using the blockchain? Well, the idea of transparency in the whole process of generating an ACCU. We're working on some regulation technology provisions that they use to actually audit the ACCUs and the before the supply gets issued by the government. So sort of providing a clean line of sight to all the sort of business processes that go on in to generate an ACCU. Do you want to?
No.
I'm like,
go for it, keep going.
And then we'll be able to provide provenance. So if we allow for these sort of trading of carbon credits internationally and across borders, then you'll be able to sort of find out where that carbon credit was generated, what project it was attached to, and that will allow us to create international standards, because right now, you know, our 33 methods that we use in Australia are not the same methods that they use in California or in Europe, et cetera, et cetera. So how do we value these credits internationally and moving them across borders?
I don't have one question.
All right.
I guess you just, I think this is a good segue about international standards. So we're seeing now the UN coming out with their sustainability goals and identifying that green finance and green bonds are really quite a focus now going forward. What was just happening in Tokyo with the 30 countries, green finance, green bonds are one of the most important discussion points. So this is a great, I guess, right, good timing to start looking at this opportunity, because in Australia we are void of policy. So I guess the question is, we are void of policy in terms of trading, in the essence of allowing people from everyday life to actually get involved with the carbon market. So how does this approach, say for example, work in Queensland? I think what I'm trying to understand here is, well, how does it work in Australia? We do have a national regulator. What role does the state play? And if we think about the Great Barrier Reef, is that an interest that we're just thinking from a storytelling perspective, the Great Barrier Reef is a great story to talk about. How would that work with the Great Barrier Reef in terms of this project?
Okay, well, the reef is an interesting case because there's a number of projects that you can do to assist with the reef. One of the major ones is building wetlands and marsh, sort of marsh areas right around the coast. Right now, those projects are only getting the carbon credits that come from the project rather than looking at sort of the nitrogen abatement that also occurs when building the wetlands. So what we would do and what has been looked at, and there's a number of other organizations that are thinking along the same lines, is you combine the sort of two tokens together in a project. So when somebody decides to do something for the environment, they're not just eligible now for carbon credits, but they're getting nitrogen credits as well. We're actually looking at an innovative sort of method of crowdsourcing methodology. And what I was thinking is that what we would do is we would use academic literature and a group of advisors to license out that method, and then as people purchase the credits and that the project rolls along, they give us information back. So it's not a pay for fee licensing to bring the credits on board. It's a pay for information, because we want information to iterate on how the method is working, is it achieving the goals that it's supposed to achieve, and then using sort of our academic advisory panel to help us iterate on these methods globally.
So just talking about the tech, you've been having conversations with Data61 and CSIRO, because they're obviously looking at this application as well. So tell me a little bit about your approach around the technology, because it's slightly different. Well, it's not slightly different, but you're understanding some of the challenges for our existing platforms, so Ethereum and things like that. So the technology is a critical element of how this comes together, as well as the discussion around the tokens, because this project is going to really push the boundaries of ASIC. And I think that's a great conversation to have in this country because it'll set a precedent.
ASIC is going to be interesting as we go for advice. The ACCU is currently classified as a financial instrument, so we will have to be compliant with an AFSL service provider, and and all of the transfers that we do overseas will have to be with AFSL partners as well. We will be regulated essentially as a financial institution. With regards to the underlying technology, I think it's a good idea at this point in time in the history of blockchain to be chain agnostic. And so what we're looking at doing is building our own chain. I get quite excited about the maths and the possibilities. So I'd like to build a fully homomorphic blockchain so that we can do underlying semantic reduction within the hash graph. So I find it really, I want something that's going to be quick and easy. We can process a lot of transactions, and we can use it because it's a permission ledger that just sort of interacts and interfaces with the existing public chains as need be for provisioning because we're building a trading platform where we need liquidity with Bitcoin and Ethereum and all of the other, we want our coin to be listed on other exchanges. So you provide the liquidity by having the intersection with your public chains, and then the internal of your ecosystem runs within a permission ledger. And so that's what I hope we're building. Let's see how we go. I think things change as you go along.
No, I agree. I think because the technology is so at the early stages, and we're still seeing even the big, like Ethereum, still dealing with, it's still not a proof of stake yet, it's still on the proof of work, even though people think differently. To be agnostic, I think, is probably a bit wise at this stage, because we just still don't know where this is going to go. So, relationship with Data 61, for me particularly, I think that's a great validation that what the EE3 project is looking at is of interest from a Commonwealth perspective. Can you explain that, please?
Well, I think that, we haven't established that partnership just yet, but we started the conversation, and I think that, so Data 61 is interested in the project because it aligns with their goals in terms of the environment and looking at carbon, but it also aligns with their functional programming team in provisioning a chain for government permissioned ledgers. So there's a lot of horizontal business cases that we could use the ledger for. And obviously using functional programming and having sort of that validity within your hash graph rather than using the consensus mechanisms of a public chain. Because, as I see it, what we'll end up doing is when we intersect with other chains, we'll use a proof of work in that get past that node, because that gives us the proof, but then everything in our chain, there's not really, they don't have the same sort of consensus.
So what's the next steps? Did you want to go through a slide on just some next steps with EE3?
Oh wow. So, the next steps in terms of what we have to get done, we need to go for ASIC advice. We need, which is quite large. We're going to be looking at either a product or a product tax ruling. We need to set up our internal financial systems so that we're compliant with ASIC regulation. And then sort of building out the community, and I think engaging with people surrounding the ICO, getting them excited about the prospect of an Australian coin that's sort of pegged to or backed by a green asset. And I think that's really something that will be exciting for Australian people. What we're helping do, if our policy doesn't change drastically within the next couple of years as we roll towards Paris 2020, we're stunting the market development and market growth that Australia can achieve in sort of the green market arena. So what we want to do is we want to help sort of push some investment into that area when it's because it's needed most. I mean, why do we have to wait until the price of carbon goes up before we can actually start planting trees? Why do we have to So we push some investment into the green market, get some of these projects on the ground, and then post 2020, when things really ramp up internationally, we've got the projects going, we're generating credits in Australia, and we can now start handing those credits out overseas. So I don't know if I really have anything else in terms of, unless you can think of other things. You asked me if I wanted to make sort of like a bit of a personal statement. Because as I started in blockchain and sort of coming from a STEM background, last year this photo impacted me. It's probably the most powerful thing that I experienced last year. I cried and cried when I saw this because I thought it was just like one of the greatest things that, a really, really important statement for women. So, they say, well, first of all, this is called Fearless Girl and on Wall Street. And the bull is supposed to represent prosperity of business and things like that. But from my perspective, what we've seen in the financial market is this sort of never-ending growth. So year-upon-year growth, and it doesn't matter where it comes from or how we're going to get there, we just need to get it done. And I think that that's where a lot of organizations have failed in terms of social corporate responsibility, because they need to continually look at this year-on-year growth. So we move factories to the developing world because, hey, we can pollute over there and we don't have to really talk about it here. And so when I was doing a corporate governance course, there was a lot of interesting material about how women on boards actually affect corporate social responsibility and how that sort of affects the way that people do business. And as it turns out, women on boards actually create more financially viable organizations. They have better risk management frameworks, and their strategic overview and business placement is a lot better than it is on all, there's a white, white male boards. There's a funny little thing people say about that. But and then, of course, that they attend to social corporate responsibility a lot better. And so I thought that this idea of women in leadership and women in blockchain was really quite an interesting intersection, because blockchain gives us the ability to take account of what's been done, the transparency that we need, we can show provenance, we can increase decentralization around decision making, that having women in blockchain and having women in leadership will really help push this knowledge revolution, the consumer revolution, and the corporate revolution that hopefully will follow. So the last sort of thing that I wanted to say was that in discussing with other women in blockchain, this idea of women in STEM, women in tech, there's a lot of sort of, I'll scratch my back, or you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours, or sort of give and take in the women, with the women in the community. And while I think that that's really important, something that I think is equally important is that we recognize the men that support women in technology and support us being here. Praise them, network them, and let other females in tech know that these are safe people to work with. Because if it weren't, if you don't have a lot of female mentors, you essentially have male mentors. And if you don't praise the male mentors that are doing good by women in tech, then we won't see more women in tech. So,
no, thanks. I agree. Because obviously we're all here today because, many, many years ago, it seems so long ago now. But when 2013 and Lucas set up the Bitcoin Brisbane meetup, it sort of paved the way for a lot of different other meetups to evolve. And it wasn't, obviously, this is one of them, and we've got Hayden here who does his. And so it's about that one person that creates the opportunity, and then we all thrive under that and get that confidence to do it. But also,
the women in blockchain has become a bit of a phenomenon around the world. And I was listening to Laura Chin's podcast Unchained, and she was talking to the woman who set up the Futures Direction, and there was a lot of interesting tweets when they came out and signed. You know, they all came together, and there was women saying, you know, I don't want to be put on a list, and I don't want to be told that I'm not here. Let's talk about what we're doing in the technology instead. And that's the message to the journalists and the media. Stop telling us that we're not here, but rather focus on what we're doing and get that message out. Because Blythe Masters was, you know, she started an incredible blockchain company that is now used by the Australian Stock Exchange for their DLT transformation. So when you look at the women who actually started companies all those years ago, Big Pizza, they're still around in the formidable countries, Bangkok, you know, there's just so many women that have been involved in those early days that still get pushed aside. But it's now, let us tell our stories. And that's why this platform is so important to me, because it enables people like, you know, women like yourself who are doing incredible stuff in this technology to have their voice and tell their stories and look here. And then we've got Shireen next month to talk about her story with Travel by Beat. Because these are important stories to be told. But I'm going to hand this to the room. I'm sure there's some questions around carbon and the tech. But thank you. Really, really appreciate it. And I just want to hand this over to the ground to any questions from the group.
But in terms of your own inputs and your maths and your physics background and the way that you work into what is the world that we now live in, and everybody else does need, you made a comment and I laughed at it, and a few other people laughed at it. We said everybody knows everything about blockchain anyway. It's our responsibility to go out there and educate people, and I think, thank you so much, because having that brain and that education and the things that you're actively working on is the start of what we need for this, for that change to happen.
Well, one of the things that I want to say, thank you for that comment. This isn't, you know, this is the knowledge revolution, and everything that you need to know about blockchain, whether you be a male or a female or, unidentified, it's out there and you can read it. So all it takes is a bit of willpower and being able to do some Google searches. But Hacker News is really good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just want to make a comment too.
Sure.
Back on your comment, Riley, about great men who advocate women in blockchain, women in technology. You can see it here in the Brisbane ecosystem. And just when I think about my recent journey, I can pinpoint it to a couple of fellows who pushed me and then were supported by some great women as well. But initially it was great men who pushed me, going, "Hey, you need to follow your course, what you want to do." And then on meetups that are specifically women focused, I've been able to make some influence in there where they were strictly women groups and say, "Would you consider opening it up to men, because with white men come in Brisbane to those meetups?" And so I've been able to make some changes with one or two in the coding industry meetup and in the UX meetup.
That's amazing. I mean, if you have a woman's meetup and then you open it up to men, you're likely only going to get the men that would really be there to support the women as you would. So you're probably not going to get the wrong sort of books in there.
Yeah, and that's how attached it to them.
Yeah, no, I think it's really important to, it's interesting because Kat and I were talking, and I mean, I started trading Bitcoin in 2012, and I never talk to my girlfriends about trading Bitcoin. All they know is that sometimes I just want to slit my throat, and sometimes things are a bit of a hurrah, we're going out for champagne. Like they don't even understand what a Bitcoin is. So, I think that's probably reflects poorly on me, and I actually need to take it take a step and maybe sit with my closest group of girlfriends and talk about what they are going to, you know, why they should be invested in cryptos, and then get over that sort of initial, like, I've got to stick something on my computer. And one of the other projects that I've been chatting with Kat about and a few other ladies that I'd like to do with the women in blockchain is under a international foundation for women in blockchain, work with Tresna to do wallets for women. And so I applied just a couple weeks back for us to get a reseller, and we've been granted that. And now I think the next step is to, you know, we'll sell some wallets and we'll use those profits to actually do a co-branded wallet for women. And then all of that money, the profits from selling the hardware wallets, will go back into the Women for Blockchain Foundation.
Yeah, brilliant. Okay. Hi, thanks very much for your presentation. We are involved in generating the carbon credit side, and we're very fortunate to have a guest from the Alcoa Corporation who generates carbon credits through emissions avoidance from savanna burning. My question is, when this wonderful blockchain system is available, and Alcoa Corporation will have a surplus of ACCUs that they have generated, how would they potentially get involved in auctioning those credits, which have community value, which have environmental value, which have been valued? How will that all come about?
Okay, so
how
there's
far
a,
away are we?
Well, hopefully we're not, yeah. I mean, I'd like to say that by the end of the year, so what we're trying to do for our initial ICO is to contract 1.2 million ACCUs. So, you know, we're about a quarter of the way there. So if you guys have extra ACCUs that you'd like to sell at a price greater than the ERF, please give me a call. And then the other thing is, like, you know, we don't yet have a way to value the extra social externalities, but eventually we'd like to see, you know, a token that's tied to those, the savanna burning method, that is maybe like an Aboriginal token, that, because it supports their local communities and their return to country. And then obviously like rural business development and things like that as well. But the short term answer is to get in on the ICO, just give me, yeah, just contact me. We'll also be doing for our pre-sale, if you have projects that you'd like to bring on board, but you actually can't get them on the ground yet because you need, you know, maybe $2, $2.50 more, then let us know, because we will be forward selling. And then those tokens that we're forward selling will have this special, the different trading rights on the platform, sort of they'll vest later as the ACCUs become available.
Will it be an auction system? So, for instance, say Qantas and Virgin are buying for more credits and they want to buy really good ones. Could they potentially, through your mechanism, auction for those so the price actually goes up to $25 instead of $16 or something, you know, because they're really hungry for those ACCUs with good social conscience behind them right now?
Well, we're not doing an auction, but it is an open marketplace. So, you know, the more demand that there is, and if there is a limited supply, the price of those credits will rise.
Sure.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Another technical question. I'm really interested in the fact that you're looking to expand internationally, but obviously the regulatory environment varies quite dramatically from country to country. Australia actually has one of the most liberal systems in place currently, and we don't really have a system that treats different coins separately. In trying to adopt that, will you sort of be rolling up different jurisdictions to limit, like the SEC in the US, for example, is not keen in that bit of South Korea, so will you sort of hold back on those jurisdictions initially and then sort of...
Yeah, well, we'll work with the organisations. So right now, in order to trade ACCUs across border or carbon credits across border, it requires a bilateral agreement. So it'd be our AFSL partner and then an AFSL partner or well, financial services partner in the organization where they want to be surrendered, and then that will allow, you know, the tokens will come onto our platform, they'll sort of trade around, And then when somebody decides that they want to surrender them against a client's obligation or just an individual that wants to surrender them, which doesn't actually happen right now, and nobody can just offset their carbon footprint right now, then we'll go and we'll do that trade so that they can be surrendered against the regulator in their country. But it will be sort of a stepwise process as we roll it out, working with countries that are going to be easier to integrate with at first. The other thing is that we're looking at, we're focusing on the ACQUI because that's a point of difference. Now, there are sort of other credits that we can bring on board, such as the Red Plus credits or the Red Gold Standard credits. Those are being used in a number of other organizations to sort of, in terms of corporate social responsibility. Now, those credits can't be surrendered against the regulator, which is why we're focusing on government methods, because we think that in terms of a compliance market and pushing the cost of these externalities into the supply chain, you know, we're going to have to work with a government method rather. But there is the potential of us bringing on these other credits for individuals or small organizations that don't have a compliance need, and in which case they can trade across borders seamlessly right now.
So much, Riley. I've always enjoyed talking with you so much. I'm so grateful and so honoured that Civic Ledger has been able to partner with you on this project, and to realise a hopefully very successful ICO and a fantastic roadmap ahead. Because I really feel that this is something of vital importance that this technology can solve.
That's right, for the environment.
So thanks, everyone. I'll build you a question.
Not a question, but I just wanted to share just sort of couple of things that have happened to me in the last couple of weeks. So, a couple of weeks ago, there was a Global Women's Startup Weekend. Peter Ellis led that at the precinct. And I was there on the first night because I dragged my youngest daughter along and she had a lot of fun. And I was sort of at one little point, I looked around and go, oh my gosh, I'm the oldest male in the room. Let's leave that aside. Peter made some comments. She said the amount of pushback she got in some of the social media about the fact that she was leading a women's startup weekend was very surprising to her. And I was a bit shocked to even hear that, why would anyone bother making a specific comment? Anyway, the feedback I got later on, one of the people that was helping to facilitate that weekend, it was his sixth startup weekend that he's been helping to organise and run, and he made the comment to me later on. He said this one had more young women that were in their early professional career participating in the weekend than what he'd seen in any other startup weekend. All the other ones, he said, yeah, there were people from uni, they're in the middle of their first degree and they don't know that much. But this had sort of stepped it up to a more serious step. And I think that actually came out in a lot of what the people were doing. Now, I just want to tie an extra little comment that I picked up. Peter Ellis also led a women's CEO or founding women's CEO to a Catalyst mission to London. And one of the things that I, in hearing some of those ladies talk, was their group decided, one of their catch cries was, we're not waiting for the invitation, we're going to invite ourselves. If we wait for the invitation, it might never come. So I just wanted to share, you know, sort of, I think you are, this whole thing is working in one of the most powerful areas I can imagine. I know of some guys, two guys from the one family that both are Rhodes Scholars, and they did politics, philosophy, and economics at Oxford. And this actually has the foundations to move economics. And then when you think about how can we apply that for people and for philosophies to make a difference for the world, this is just sort of one of the most exciting things happening in Brisbane at all. So, sorry, too many words. Invite yourselves, please, to all the things that go to, because and then in the area of blockchain, I love what you're talking about, because when you can actually re-architect the foundations of some of the stuff that will be important for the future. It just can change the world.
Yeah, I agree that this, you know, that right now we have to think about those foundations, because if we set things up now and we don't expose the business logic that needs to be exposed in order to have that knowledge that we need to make better decisions, then we're essentially just rebuilding the same old system. So yeah, getting in now and doing the work now is the important bit.
And your comment about Flux working for the long term, I think the long term might only be 20 to 30 years, not absolutely not in the 70 or 100 or longer. That now is a very, very unique time for actually using these levers to actually create a child.
It is, but it would be exciting and potentially scary if it happened in the next 15 to 20 years. Because like I said, we need that sort of democratic education to go with implementing this system. And it's the sort of the balance of the knowledge and how to use the system as a, you know, if we flicked a switch tomorrow and we were all driving the country in terms of the economy. And yeah, it could be a bit disastrous.
I just also just like to acknowledge that it's International Women's Week this week coming up, so there's a lot of events going on around the city, so please participate wherever you find an event. Okay, thanks everyone. Thank you.